physical world, but he will repeat it as he was repeating during the time when he was longing to know God, to realize God. But even then he can tell you this much: from the very time he started repeating the name, he began to feel the sweetness of it. So he used to pray to God, he does not want anything else, only he wants your name. No, he does not want to see you, let your name be ever on this time. It's because he found his soul is sweet, sweet. And so it proved to be not a means to an end, but an end in itself. This is the wonder about that name repeating, because it depends upon the repeater, of course, and not merely. Because unless we are free from the low passions of the heart, we cannot find the sweetness of the name. You see, sugar is sweet. By nature it is sweet. It can never be bitter. So name is by nature sweet, it can never be bitter. But when this sugar is put in the mouth of a man who is having some kind of fever, he finds the taste not sweet but bitter. He throws it away. And that shows, you see, the man is deceived. This sugar is sweet. So when we are deceived with the low desires, the name does not taste sweet to us. So we must go to a doctor who can cure us of that disease. Doctor is the guru who, by his presence, removes our disease of desires and gives us this nectar name. And we find that instant, you see, it is sweet. And the sweetness continues as long as you are going on repeating the name, until at last you become sweetness itself. Not merely the taste of the sweetness, but the sweetness itself. And so you drink and drink and drink the name until the drinker and the drink become one. As the chant in the mantra given to him by the Guru, word after word, will you kindly join him? For that you are individually doing, you can go on doing this. For the present occasion, we shall always repeat Ramana and enjoy the bliss of it.
Jai Ram, 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 Question, Swamiji, because Ramdas's Ram is a wonderful Ram, so also perhaps the God whom so many saints and sages of the world realize, Ramdas feels his presence every moment of his life, still he is unable to tell you what he is like. Because omnipresence of God is one of his attributes. Omnipresence is one of his attributes. And to describe what that omnipresence is not so easy. One can feel about it but cannot express what it is like. At the beginning, when God wanted him to walk on the path of God realization, it is that he started repeating the name Ram, 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 simply the two letters. But at that time he has a very hazy idea what Ram should be. But this much he did, his mind waves gradually fell down and he enjoyed a certain measure of peace. But later on the Guru came to him and initiated him into the mantra Om Sri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram. He did not tell him the meaning of the word Ram, whether he is Dashrath's son Ram, the historical or mythological Ram, or he meant that the name stood for the all-pervading, omnipresent God. After he started chanting the mantra Om Sri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram, within a very short time he reached a state of mental exaltation, elevation, full of light and peace, so much so at times he used to lose himself in a higher consciousness, forgetting the body. He was repeating the mantra incessantly, almost throughout the whole day and night. One night, when he was engaged in the chanting of the mantra, he saw before him the image of Lord Krishna. It was a wonderful vision. He saw Lord Krishna dancing before him with his flute in his hand. He was playing on the flute and at the same time dancing. The charming figure fascinated him, but he knew that that figure will not remain before him for long. It will vanish and will throw him into a state of agony. So at that time itself he prayed to Krishna that he was not satisfied with that vision, but he wanted the universal vision of the Lord, so that he can remain conscious of God's presence at all times, behold Him at all times, be in union with Him at all times. Because in the Bhagavad Gita, it is stated that the highest vision is universal vision, after which there is no fall for the aspirant, because the aspirant becomes one with the divine. Divine and the aspirant, they lose the distinction and the aspirant becomes the very embodiment of the divine. After the darshan of mercy, God took him up the hill Arunachala, which was the place of austerities of the Maharshi. Because for long years it was said that Maharshi did tapasya on that hill. He went up the hill and found a small cave suitable for him to stay for some days. He entered the cave and remained there for 20 days and 20 nights. All the time he was repeating the mantra given to him by the Guru. After the 20th day, when he came out of the cave, he found his eyes filled with a strange light and he could behold everywhere the divine, in stones, trees, in plants, and everywhere he felt one tremendous presence. And there was attraction outside, and he cried out that he saw Ram everywhere, went about like one gone mad, embracing trees, rocks, and anybody passing by also, he went to rush towards him and embraced him. In this state of frenzy, it was nothing short of a frenzy that seized him, he felt that he had gained that vision which was promised to him, as it were, by Krishna when that darshan was given to him by him in his beautiful, charming form which is well known to all the devotees of Krishna. He felt from that day forward that a veritable fountain of bliss was opened within him, and he was inundated with that bliss to such an extent it continues to pour out even to this very day. Day and night he was immersed in an ocean of bliss, an ocean of joy, which is so intense it baffles description. And the purity which was gained after that vision is unparalleled. He knew when he was made to enter the path that he would, by the grace of God and through the continuous repetition of his name, he would attain to a purity which he thought would be, which was imaginable. But when he got it, he found that every vestige of desire was eradicated out of his heart, because he was filled through and through with that joy and love, and there was no scope for anything else to remain in him. No undivine impulse, no undivine desire or attachment would any way affect him. He was completely divinized through and through, inside, outside, senses, body, impulses, intellect, and every part, every aspect of his being. This is a result of the vision that he got on that hill. Thereafter he used to go about from place to place extolling the greatness of God's name. He told the people who were round about him that name is the way by which you can attain the highest spiritual eminence and fill yourself with the divine presence, divine joy, divine peace, and your heart thereafter will surely flow out with love towards the whole creation without distinction of race, caste, creed, color, or any difference of any kind. Now the whole universe stands transformed before his vision as God himself. There's another sentence in the Upanishad which aptly describes what Ramdas' present state is. Sarvam kalviram brahma. Everything verily is Brahman. Wherever you see it is he. Up, down, this side, that side, in all directions you have the vision of the divine. Because you are made first to see divine within you. When in the early stages of his struggle to attain him, he was oblivious of the earth for some time, oblivious of the world and all beings in it. His vision was mainly internal. He was lost in it. And after that it was that this external vision flowered out of it, and he could behold the whole universe changed, transformed for him as the very expression of God. Everywhere where there was God for him, all distinctions were lost. All differences disappeared. He would feel one with each and everybody. Ramdas remembers an example given by Swami Ramdas. He has given this because it may be found in the scriptures also, based upon what he read in scriptures. He must have given this example. That example is a man, in order to have some fun, got innumerable small mirrors and got them fixed up in his room, on the walls, on the ceiling, on the floor, on all sides. And then after closing the door, he put on the light and stood in the middle of the room and looked around, and he saw himself reflected in 1,000 forms in the mirrors above him, below him, on all sides of him, and he enjoyed the sight very much, because he could see himself everywhere. In that sea he enjoyed so much. When he went out, he forgot to close the door, and the dog entered. And the dog saw that there are so many dogs around him, and began to bark at them, fight them, jump at them, in the wall and down, up, everywhere, because it was thinking the dogs were separate from them, from him. And then exhausted it died, appears there, because it barked and fought against those dogs, only his reflections. So man in a state of ignorance and fights and fellow beings, thinking they are separate from him. But a man who knows, a man who has that universal vision and God vision, sees himself everywhere, loves everybody as himself, and he has no quarrel with anybody, he has no dislike or hate for anybody. This vision purifies your heart through and through, and that is why out of such a heart flows of love towards everybody alike, because when you love others, in fact you love yourself. Here the saying of Jesus has been fulfilled in such a life as this: love thy neighbor as thyself. How can you love thy neighbor as thyself unless you know inwardly that you and he are one? In Atman we are all one, in manifestation we appear to be different. Just as a piece of gold converted into several kinds of ornaments bear separate names and separate forms, but they are all made of one gold, so one Atman pervading everywhere has assumed all these forms. If you see things through the vision of the Atman, then that you don't see any difference. Everyone you see as expression yourself, as a manifestation yourself. This is the supreme vision held forth in the Bhagavad Gita. Vishwarupa Darshan is nothing but the vision of the divinity everywhere. Vision of yourself, your higher, real, immortal self, manifests as entire universe and all beings and creatures and things in it.
No.
after the sadhana, he found one thing, and that is continuous remembrance of God. In Hindi, it's called Smaran or Smaran, means continuous thought of God running in our mind like a stream, distinct and complete self-surrender, offering yourself completely to God and freeing yourself from ego sense and the universal vision are one and the same. Because continuous remembrance of God does not permit of the existence of the ego in you, and self-surrender necessarily dissolves the ego sense. With the result, immediately you will have universal vision, because you know that you are not the body, but the all-pervading, static, silent Brahman. And this realization does not remain there as it is, but at once grants you the vision of the whole universe as the expression of that all-pervading, static Brahman. Then it is that you say that everything is Brahman. Verily everything is Brahman. Then you realize that the manifestation is He, and the unmanifest, all-pervading reality underlying this manifestation is also He. These two aspects you see as one ultimately, because they are not separate, but they are described as Shiva and Shakti. Shiva is the static aspect and Shakti is the dynamic aspect. These two aspects coexist simultaneously in the reality, and you so see no distinction between them. When you see no distinction, then it is that you are completely free from the ego self, and you become the embodiment of divinity, and your works are not your works, but the works of Shakti, and you yourself are not the individual, but the all-pervading universal Brahman. Then it is said, as in the Bhagavad Gita, you are doing action as if you are not doing anything. As Prakriti or Shakti you are doing everything, as Brahman you are not doing anything. In this state of supreme yoga, union with God in all its aspects, you are doing and not doing at the same time. This is the meaning of the shloka, which conveys action in action, in action in action. How can these two things be possible? They can be possible only when you understand the Paramashiva, who is at once Purusha and Prakriti, or Shiva and Shakti, and they coexist so much so that they lose distinction. These are the two opposites. Dynamism and static states are two different things. Still, wonderfully, they coexist in God. God is at once active and not active. And the active spirit, you are doing everything. As an inactive spirit, you are not doing anything. So Arjuna was asked on the battlefield to fight in the spirit so that he can do action on the battlefield, still remain as if he has not done anything. Instead of running away from the battlefield, he said, I will teach you a yoga by which you can do action in the battlefield, still remain as if you have not done anything. This is the spirit in which we have to live in the world. We must live, move and do everything in the world as if we have not done anything. That requires what you call jnana first. Jnana means knowledge of the self, which is silent, serene, inactive spirit. And then do all actions through Prakriti, and the Prakriti's action has no impress, no effect upon the Brahman, who is only a witness, a spectator. Calmly, silently seeing the workings of Prakriti, sanctioning it, throwing light on it in order to make the Shakti create, preserve and destroy. These three aspects of Prakriti are seen clearly and done to the sanction of that silent, serene spirit, radiant, full of light. And that spirit is called Swayam Prakasha, means self-luminous. That light itself is activating the Prakriti and make her active in this universal manifestation, which is nothing but her own manifestation. So in bodies we are only Prakriti. The other Atman is the Purusha. So these two exist together in us, and if we realize this truth, then we can be free and still we will be active in the world. And those actions will be of universal significance because they are done by universal Shakti. When she becomes the doer in us, then your action flows spontaneously for the good of humanity, not for individual benefit or for this purpose of this person and that person or for my own use, because I, you and he are completely absent in that vision experience, and your action necessarily prove to be of the universal significance done in the standpoint of the universal truth. So you live as an embodiment of the universe, universal power, universal truth, universal light.
राम नाम अति मीठा है कोई गाके देख ले राम नाम अति मीठा है कोई गाके देख ले आ जाते हैं राम कोई बुला के देख ले I'm not afraid. खेल।